And I can assure you, both of these issues are, you know, I'm in charge of these and some other issues. I can assure you that at the highest level, this is now recognized that we need a massive transformation in higher education, and we need a massive improvement in skill development. If you look at the old numbers, you know, 39% of our workers are illiterate. Some 41%, I'm told, it's somewhat dated, the old data, but 39% illiterate and 41% who have not gone beyond 10th standard. So, you know, with that kind of labor force and which does not have the appropriate skills, how are we going to maintain the momentum of growth even if we achieve that? So, moral of the story is, while it is very much possible to achieve 10% growth, while it is very much possible, we have everything that it takes to go there and to become an economic superpower and move in that direction. However, everything is contingent on our ability to put our house in order insofar as the higher education and skill development is concerned. Now, what is happening today about both this, as I was saying, at the highest level, at the Prime Minister's level, this is fully recognized and a lot of things are happening. In fact, I dare say that in the field of higher education, the kind of changes which are taking place or which are on the front burner, if I may say, are just unbelievable. Again, I want to make a strong statement. In the next 18 months, the higher education system in our country would become unrecognizably different from what it has always been. It requires huge investment, and it requires a massive improvement in quality. There are at least 5 bills which are pending at various levels, various stages, and all of them are truly earth-shaking. Never before, so many different reforms in education were taking place at the same time. I just want to give you quickly a rundown. First one is that, you know, we have 15 regulators, UGC and AICTE and NCTE, and so all the alphabets have been exhausted, and then we have professional council. But the harmony or their working together, you know, the level of incompetence of these have never been more. The level of corruption in these has never been more. So there were 2 very important committees appointed. One was by the National Knowledge Commission, and there was another committee. These 2 committees made very important recommendations. All of them thought that these 15 regulators or professional councils which are there should be collapsed, should be abolished, and they should be collapsed into one institution, and that is happening. It's going to be called National Commission on Higher Education and Research. And Prime Minister has appointed a task force, and I'm part of the task force. What we have done is that we wrote the first draft bill creating this National Commission on Higher Education Research. It was put on the website. We went all over the country debating with the educationists and the officials from the education sector, and further changes were made. The third and final draft was presented to the Honorable Prime Minister. A presentation was made to the Honorable Prime Minister about 4 weeks back, and now it will move on to become a cabinet note and then on to the parliament. And when the session is actually held, if at all, we don't know, then it would be discussed in that. This is going to be a very important change, but in addition to that, there are 4 other major bills which are in the offing. Take the case of, you know, and the Vice Chancellors, I know, and I'm sure Jyoti Ben would remember that one of the favorite habits of academician is to keep complaining about everybody else. Everybody complains about everybody else, and Vice Chancellors end up spending a lot of their disproportionately large amount of time just dealing with those complaints. Now, there is a respite. They are going to appoint state-level tribunals and the central-level tribunals, which will take care of all these litigation matters. 2. Third, accreditation. Can you imagine? Only about 20% of universities are accredited. Nobody knows their accreditation, you know, their ranking, etc. Now, because until now it was not mandatory, it is going to be made mandatory. That bill has already been moved.
So accreditation,
if all goes well, accreditation would become mandatory. There would be accreditation not only of universities but also colleges, and accreditation of individual departments of universities. And that will be eye-opener about many universities that that we see around, because many of them, you know, they don't announce that they have not been accredited, and they don't announce it in any case. So that will change. Fourth one is about the medical education and engineering education. There is a bill to bill for prevention of malpractices in engineering and medical education, because that is an area where malpractices are truly gigantic proportions. So all those will be taken care of. And the fifth one is, of course, the foreign education providers bill. At different levels, these five bills are there, and they would hopefully become acts in the near future, and that will change the entire higher education system. Take the case of the skill development. Prime Minister is personally looking into this, and what has been done is very interesting. At the central government level, there are three agencies created. One is the National Mission on Skill Development, which is headed by Honorable Prime Minister himself. And the second one is that there are 17 ministries dealing with skill development. You know, the largest one, of course, is the Ministry of Labour. But the HRD is also involved, the textiles is also involved. The coordination between these 17 ministries is worse than zero, because there are all kinds of platforms. So the second organization that has been created by the Prime Minister is the National Skill Development Coordination Board. That is chaired by Montek Aluwalia, Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission. Me and many others are members of that, and that has started working. The third one is a truly PPP kind of thing, public-private partnership. In the Ministry of Finance, National Skill Development Corporation has been created, and they are doing the skill mapping, and very good work is being done with private, taking private sector along. So that is the National Skill Development Corporation. This is at the central government level. At the state government level, Prime Minister wrote a personal letter to all the chief ministers in August 2008 to create a state-level skill development mission. When I took over the Planning Commission, one of the first things that I did was to have a press conference, have a video conference of all the chief secretaries. And I asked them one simple question. The Prime Minister wrote a letter to your chief minister. What have you done about it? I was appalled to see that 60% of the states had not even made a beginning after 2 years. So this is really very serious. So, but now in the last few months, now there is a momentum. You see, Planning Commission has held 6 regional conferences where all the states left to themselves. You know, they believe that they are ahead of everybody. But when I made them make a presentation of where they stand, you know, it was very clear. Some states have done fabulously well, and some states have done awful job. One of those 6 conferences were held in Mumbai, where I personally invited representatives from Gujarat as well as 4 or 5 other states. The point is, that is gaining momentum. The target given, and this is where I am coming to what industry needs to do about this. The target that has been given by the Honorable Prime Minister is that by the year 2022, we must have 500 million people who are skilled. That is the target, which is very, very ambitious target from where we stand now. So by 2022, we must have 500 million people, 50 crore people who are fully skilled. Because by that time, by the year 2022, I would imagine that almost all countries, including China, will have acute shortage of trained personnel, and India can potentially be the provider of those resources, provided that we train our people. Otherwise, it is in that sense that I'm saying that, you know, population is not a problem, but if we don't train them, if we don't give the right kind of education, right kind of training, we'll be adding mouths to feed, but will not add hands that work. And if that happens, that would be a demographic disaster, because what we are counting on as a demographic dividend, there's nothing automatic about it. If we don't put our act together in the field of education and skill development, this can become a millstone around our neck. And it would be an unmitigated disaster if we don't put our act together now. The advantage, the so-called demographic dividend advantage that we have, is going to last for about 15 to 20 years, 25 years at top.